This is Duke University.
Global trade and environmental
justice. Human rights issues are still.
The term Ubuntu.
But the Alien and Sedition Act
is making inferential discoveries.
The importance of an archive.
The John Hope Franklin Center.
Nearly 40 years after the Kerner Commission report led to the diversifying of America's newsrooms, we find that those newsrooms increasingly are devoid of African Americans and Black Americans talking about their realities. Amy Alexander understands that reality, and she talks about it in her new book, Uncovering Race, which is an African American journalist's view of what's happening with race in reporting. And later we're joined by filmmaker John Akomfrah, who next year will celebrate the 30th anniversary of the Black Audio Film Collective, a groundbreaking collective of musicians and artists and filmmakers from Britain. You're watching Left to Black, and I am Mark Anthony Neal. Welcome to Left to Black. I'm your host, Mark Anthony Neal, and we are joined this afternoon by veteran journalist Amy Alexander, the author of the new book, Uncovering Race, A Black Journalist's Story of Reporting and Reinvention, just published this October by Beacon Press. Amy Alexander was a 2008 fellow at the Nation Institute, and she has worked at numerous publications, including the Miami Herald, the Boston Globe, Africana.com, where we first connected, and National Public Radio. How are you doing today, Amy?
I'm great. This is really wonderful to be here, Mark. I appreciate it.
There have been many signature books that have been written about the experiences of Black journalists. I think about Jill Nelson's book, Volunteer Slavery, you know, from almost 20 years ago, as an example. What stimulated you to think about trying to tell your story and the story of what you've observed in America's newsrooms, you know, over the last 20 years?
Well, Jill's book was certainly inspiring. You know, I was probably at year number 5 or maybe 6 in journalism when her book came out. And I remember just being riveted by it, you know, because there were so few people like me in the newsroom, you know, where I worked. And so her book was certainly inspiring. And more recently, I've been what spurred this particular book, Uncovering Race, was the several years I wrote a column for Africana, Mark Anthony Neal, our alma mater.
Yes.
the fantastic web magazine that was published out of Cambridge for several years. And I wrote a column there about race in media. And, you know, it's interesting to think now both about that vehicle, the fact that that website was there and it published every day, but the columnists, you know, we thought of ourselves as columnists.
Absolutely. We didn't think of ourselves as bloggers, right?
We thought of as bloggers, and we didn't write every single day. We weren't updating constantly. I mean, my column only went up every other Monday, which now, of course, seems like a snail's pace.
Yes.
But what I think, I hope you agree and your viewers agree, what we were able to achieve and what I certainly was trying for with that column was a real kind of more thoughtful look at race and media in America. And now, in hindsight, we realize that was a kind of a turning point where the web began to ascend in terms of mass media in America. And, you know, newspapers really were kind of declining in the late 90s and early aughts. So this, the years that I wrote that column, you know, I thought initially that I would do a book that was purely a collection of those columns, you know, just sort of stack them up and maybe refresh them here or there or write around them to bring the main topic of race and media up to date. But as I proceeded with that tack and just sort of assembling them and pulling down the columns and looking at the kind of sub-themes that was in each column, I went back to my publisher, my editor at Beacon Press in Boston, and I said, you know, I don't know if this format is really going to be appropriate because things are changing so fast.
Right.
I mean, you know, it's by the second.
Yeah.
I mean, and I'm doing my first Skype interview. So, you know, it's in flux, and I just felt it would be better to reframe it. I mean, keep the same theme, which is, you know, how do people of color, gay people, other marginalized groups and communities and issues in America get covered? That's the first goal of what I was wanting to do. And the second goal was to really look at how the changes in media are affecting the practitioners who previously were the ones who delivered the news and information, for better or worse, and, you know, fulsomely or sketchily. There used to be only journalists that would that would tell what was going on in the world. Now that's completely
different. That's totally changed, yeah. We're watching, you're watching Left to Black. I'm Mark Anthony, your host. We're joined by Amy Alexander and talking about her new book, Uncovering Race, A Black Journalist's Story of Reporting and Reinvention. And quickly, let's give a quick shout out to Kate Tuttle, who edited many of our pieces at Africana.com. One of the things I loved about your story, Amy, is that, you know, when we think about folks who are professional journalists now and they all go to the top-notch J schools and, you know, they're going to Annenberg and places like this, your trajectory is a little different. You went to San Francisco State. You talk, you know, very honestly at the beginning of the book that you had certain expectations about what you would be able to do as a journalist as you're coming out of journalism school, and never thought twice about the fact that, you know, you weren't branded the right kind of way.
That's right. And, you know, it was almost like a slow dawning thing, but, you know, but certainly by the time I hit my 10th year in journalism, it became utterly clear to me that as important as the race of the journalist is, and I'm not saying that that's been an acceptable dynamic, but it is the way it has been, almost equally important is the sort of the economic class background, the experiences that the journalist hails from, or from which the journalist hails. And I come from, you know, I considered myself, I mean, I'm proudly a working class, you know, to middle class background. You know, my family were government workers, and we grew up in working class San Francisco in the 60s and 70s. And I'm proud of that. But I'm also very accomplished. And I've been a really good journalist for a long time. But it has become more acutely apparent to me, certainly as the blogosphere and the internet ascends and the jobs become fewer, that there is a real kind of elitism, and I don't mean purely in a political sense, I mean it almost mostly in a class sense, that exists in many news organizations. And frankly, I think it's going to contribute to the continuing spiral of what we call legacy media or traditional media, because a lot of the people in these newsrooms, certainly the big papers that remain, there's a big gap between their experiences and their expectations about the way the world is, the way Americans live, how Americans are making their way, and the people that are supposed to be delivering the news. They have a lot of money. They certainly, here in Washington, where I am, you know, it's crazy. The D.C. press corps is crazy. I will tell you that.
It's interesting because, you know, you get started early on in your career, San Francisco Examiner, and you're covering disasters, right? You know, the San Francisco earthquake happens in 1989, and you write about the fact that there's a kind of excitement about that you liked.
But
who knew that you would also have that same kind of excitement having to cover and talk about race in the same context? I was struck by, you know, your kind of detailing of early experiences you had with editors, where you wrote pieces that you were very passionate about, that you thought were important, using language that was sensitive to the subject broadly, but also specifically in the stories, and generally white male editors would change words and generally push your pieces to better reflect a kind of mainstream white sensibility about the world. I mean, how frustrating was that, and how willing were you to push back in some of these situations?
Right. Well, those are great. Those are key questions. And that's a big part of the core of why I wanted to write this book. You know, it's not a new situation. Jill wrote about it. Pamela Newkirk in her book, right, Within the Veil, from, right, I think 2000, her book was published. Oh, I should say that's another book that inspired me. But it was extremely frustrating. It was a little bit, it could be scary and intimidating at times, because obviously I didn't want to lose my job. You know, right. I'm not a trust fund journalist who's like trying this out until, you know, I decide to go to law school. I mean, I wanted to succeed in the profession, and I didn't have a lot of resources outside of any given staff writing job I had over the years. But it could be, you know, initially I would feel very frustrated. And, you know, if I push back, there might be some give and take. You know, it always depended on the personality of the given editor. And in fairness, I really only had two or three sort of major episodes. And I'm pretty sure I detailed two of them in the book. One was around the coverage of the LA riots, where an editor inserted objectionable language into my stories about having covered the LA riots live. You know, people may not remember all the details, but it was a huge conflagration that week. Right. And it was turmoil on the streets and rioting and shooting.
Right.
And I really had to walk the line of objectivity because I felt like, yeah, you know, if I weren't doing this job, I might be out here burning stuff too, you know, over the King verdict. But I had to walk the line. I couldn't be writing stories saying, you know, it's people should be angry and this is the right response, because that wasn't my job, right?
No.
But the editor felt, in that guy in Fresno, where we would send the stories via the wire up to Fresno.
And he's hundreds of miles away from the action.
He's 300 odd miles away, sitting at his desk, watching it on TV. And he sees our stories come across. He says, oh no, you know, we have to make this. I don't know if he was going for drama, you know, but probably, I mean, psychologists have studied this sort of thing. Your biases, you carry your biases, you know, they don't go away. And that is why it is so important to have whatever news organization, or whether it's a website, whatever the vehicle is, you must have people who have, you know, at the very least, open-mindedness.
Yeah.
And who are prepared, or at least accepting, if a new idea or a new wrinkle gets introduced, and not just continuously try and say, well, you know, that can't really be, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
There's a line between your natural skepticism as a journalist and where your biases override that and sort of lead you to doing things similar to what that editor did. Another episode, and it was the same editor in Fresno, is involved a black woman who had been convicted of, found guilty of child abuse. And
this is the Norplant case, right?
The Norplant case.
Right, yeah.
It was Orwellian. You know, this white judge decided that this poor black woman who had four kids, who was pregnant with her fifth, who neighbors accused of having beaten her, one of her children, shows up in the courtroom, and at the sentencing, the judge says, we're going to have you take Norplant, which, you know, I don't see it around anymore, but it was approved in the early 90s, and it was a little tube-like.
And nobody knew what it was, and clearly the folks who were being asked to use it didn't know what it was. Right?
That's right. I mean, it literally had been, I believe, this case happened early in 91, I think, you know, early that year, 91, and that version of birth control had only been approved maybe a month earlier or two. Really new.
Right.
And this guy decides he's going to have this thing slipped in. The way it used to work is they would slip it in your upper arm about an inch or half an inch beneath your skin, and it would drip release a contraceptive.
For 5 years,
Five. The head nearly blew off, right? So that was a very important story because it raises all number of issues. And I, in my heart and in my intellect, believed that judge would never have made that kind of a sentence to a middle-class person, A, and a white person, B.
Yeah.
And so that, you know, I had back and forth with the editor because he kept insisting that, you know, the coverage of that case, and as it unspooled over several months, he kept saying, well, we have to be straight down the line, we have to be fair. But what he meant was he did not want to portray that black woman in any way that could be perceived as sympathetic.
Right.
And I had a problem with that. Yeah. I mean, I wasn't trying to over-sympathize her, but I wanted to portray her as she was. She had failings, but she had good points too. That was my job.
You're watching Left to Black. We're joined by Amy Alexander, author of the new book, Uncovering Race, A Black Journalist's Story of Reporting and Reinvention. That's Beacon Press, 2011. In some ways, when you're covering the LA riots in 92, it's full circle, right? In the aftermath of Watts in 1965, in the Kerner Commission report, there was a lot of pressure on news agencies and news outlets to, for lack of a better way to describe it, diversify their newsrooms, right? In some ways, they just simply needed Negro bodies to be able to go into the field and navigate those spaces and not be so, you know, visible, you know, if you will. But we go forward to 2005. I mean, this is, you know, 40 years after the Watts riots, and we look at a report that comes from the NACT Foundation, and they make the point that diversity has passed its peak in America's newsrooms, right? And then you tell that incredible story that here on the eve of the first black president being elected, NPR decides to close down, you know, one of its programs that's specifically dedicated to covering black life. Talk a little bit about, you know, what is at play now. We know the economic realities that are out there, but why are America's newsrooms becoming ironically whiter at this time when blackness is so pervasive in the society?
That's right, and brownness.
And brownness, right.
Yeah, I mean, it's the demographics are rapidly changing. We all know this. You know, we've all seen the census projections. And, you know, Mark, I think it comes down to power. I think that it's not, you know, you're a historian like I am. You're a real historian. You know, you really do real deep dish history. I'm kind of an amateur student of history, but it's not unusual that the dominant group never wants to give up power. Yeah. I mean, who does? Who wants to give up power? And I don't want to oversimplify it, but I do believe that the gatekeepers of certainly of what we now think of as the mainstream press, legacy media, the traditional news organizations, be they on the airwaves or in print or on the web now, there is a status quo of mindset that is just really entrenched. You know, and obviously there are exceptions. There are always little pockets of individuals who are maybe, for want of a better term, progressive, who really do believe that inclusion is going to improve their bottom line in terms of, you know, providing coverage that more accurately, consistently accurately reflects what is really going on with people, the way America looks right now. But apparently, you know, the prevailing leadership at these organizations is still kind of stuck in the mindset of hiring people that they feel comfortable with. So this is one of these ephemeral things that the social scientists and the big brains who study how to improve media, you know, the you always hear the word monetizing. How's the new landscape of media going to be monetized? People don't want to read printed products anymore. Nobody wants to pay for news on the web. How's it going to be monetized? So they study algorithms and metrics, and they have all these formulas and stuff. But what they're not studying is, in my mind, one of the most potentially simple solutions to keeping the eyeballs coming back to your news and information is to have news and information that the current population really wants to read.
I mean, it's a no-brainer, right?
Yeah, you mentioned News and Notes, and that's another news organization that you and I were affiliated with.
Right.
And it was fantastic. It was high quality.
Absolutely.
It had a team of really highly skilled professionals, not all of whom were black, but the leader, you know, certainly the main hosts were black.
Right, and Tavis and
that's right.
Ed Gordon, right, yeah.
That's right, and its editorial content, its theme, rather, was to talk about issues of relevance to not just black Americans, but, you know, people of the African diaspora and other marginalized groups broadly. And now Michelle Martin's show is the same way.
Tell me more.
But NPR, you know, it's complicated. They have, they're well-meaning, as my mom would say. Well, you know, they're well-meaning. Yeah. But they can't seem to get it right. And I attribute that to this status quo mentality, that's this mindset of, well, A, we know what we're doing. Right. You know, we're good. We're good-hearted. We're well-meaning.
Right.
We want to cover race and class, but they don't really know how to do it. And they're reluctant. Again, this is the power thing, not wanting to give up your power. Because if you're running an organization, you probably don't want to give it up. You know, if you're running a department, or if you're running your own little show, whatever your power base is, you don't want to give it up. So the idea of letting in certainly newcomers and people maybe that don't look like you or didn't go to the same college as you, it can be, you know, a tricky thing.
Yeah.
So I think, I mean, that's a big piece of it.
And it's interesting, right? Because, you know, that's really an across-the-board crisis that's attached to American institutions in general. You know, whether that we're talking about professional sports or higher education, this unwillingness to surround yourself, leadership positions, unwilling to surround themselves with folks who might think a little differently, might process the world a little differently.
That's right.
You cite Hurricane Katrina, for instance, as this kind of watershed moment, this signpost for a real shift in terms of the legacy media, traditional media, and who starts to cover the news. I mean, there are young folks who are much more willing to trust TMZ or something that they read on Twitter before they're going to go to any of the big three networks, for instance, you know, to get a news story. In this context, of course, we've seen the proliferation of the blogosphere, right? And I don't even want to deal with social media yet, but everyone has a blog, right?
That's right.
And it's been this interesting moment because we've recognized a very powerful democratization of opinion. The problem is that that doesn't necessarily mean there's a democratization of skill.
That's right.
In that same context. And now with everyone having equal footing, you know, we now have a generation of young folks, you know, who simply don't have the skill set to be successful journalists, to be successful writers, but yet are prominently displayed and have hundreds of thousands of followers.
Yes, that's right. Because
on yeah.
I mean, the whole media literacy piece, you know, I before we began, you got a glimpse at my 12-year-old daughter who's hanging around today. And I do. I'm concerned about the young, suffer the children, right? I mean, and I don't want to be glib, but media literacy is I think, it is going to become more important that people are able to be discerning, right?
Right.
So, in other words, be able to tell the difference between what is just the facts, ma'am, what is the news and information that's
right.
been vetted and reported and has been verified, and what is conjecture or buzz or
editorial slant, right? I mean,
yeah,
all those things, right?
With a partisan political slant. I mean, it's all kind of getting balled up now. And in generational terms, I am concerned. I mean, I don't really speculate in the book. I mean, I leave it kind of open-ended because I don't know what the future will look like in terms of people's ability to depend on reliable news and information to help them make, you know, rational decisions about the way they feel, where they want to live, where they want to go to school. I mean, clearly, ideally, people should, you know, be their own fact checker. Right.
Yeah.
And, you know, but that's not always going to be possible. And we have to admit that media is influential. It influences the way people see themselves. It influences the way they see their neighbor. And it can be a little discouraging to think that there are so many vehicles now that are kind of sowing division, and that, you know, people get so entrenched in whatever their thing is, and they spew it out via the internet, and anyone who maybe has questions or who thinks that they want answers, if for whatever reason they find one line of thought that appeals to them, they can just keep drilling down.
Keep going. Yeah.
They could get completely lost in whatever it is, right? Whether it's gardening or white supremacy. And just shut out anything else.
Yeah.
So I kind of go back and forth. I mean, as I say in the book, I think it's a moment of promise and peril for consumers who are kind of hungry for news and information about certainly the way the demographics in America are changing. You can find plenty of online publications that are really doing a good job of describing and charting the way America is changing for better and worse, but you can also find many, many online places that are providing information that I personally find harmful.
Yeah. You're watching Left to Black. I'm Mark Anthony Neal. We're joined by journalists, veteran journalists, award-winning journalists, Amy Alexander, who's the author of the new book, Uncovering Race, A Black Journalist's Story of Reporting and Reinvention.
Katrina, I'm sorry, I didn't mention, yes, I'm sorry, I forgot that part. Katrina was somewhat of a turning point, I think. I mean, it might be too soon to tell. But the main feature, in hindsight, when I went back and reviewed a lot of the coverage as I was writing this book, and it became so much more clear in the aftermath that the mainstream journalists, the sort of legacy journalists on the airwaves and in print, kind of were left in the dust by the new media
practitioners. New media, right, absolutely.
And they were they were literally moving around much more adeptly.
With handheld cameras and flip cameras and recorders and
And they were producing those really riveting, heartbreaking images first of the of people being essentially left to drown in that great city. And that kind of drove the traditional journalists in that direction. So in that respect, it was a good thing. You know, it was a American public media is the first outlet, and their public media, they're kind of mainstream, but they're also kind of fringe a little bit. But they are the outlet. If you and I didn't put this in the book, but they're the outlet that first published that 20-second clip of Barbara Bush in the Superdome. Yeah. You know what I'm talking about? At that moment where she was overheard saying something like, you know, many of these people were poor and jacked up anyway, so for them to have
Sheldon, right, life is better for them now, right?
Yeah, you know, and people, I mean, that was like a stunning moment.
Yeah.
And that someone had captured that on their cell phone, and somehow it got to American, you know, and out it went over the air.
Yeah.
And I find that a few years after that, you could see when the Haiti earthquake happened.
Right.
That the journalists from places like CNN and from the traditional newspapers really tried to achieve that same kind of not only instantaneous coverage, but the narrative about the fact that race and class and the fact that, you know, people without a lot of resources suffer exponentially more in a big disaster. Right. That was an instant thing. That was an instant part of the narrative. Of course, Haiti is Haiti. But in Katrina, by contrast, in the immediate aftermath of Katrina, as Jack Schaefer, the former Slate media writer, put it, it took many, many news cycles before any of the mainstream journalists pointed out, a lot of these people are black, and maybe the government just kind of don't care about them.
Right. Kanye had to point them to that fact, right? one last thing, Amy. You know, you think about institutions like Chicago Defender, Amsterdam News in New York, Ebony, Jet Magazine, Essence. Where's the black press in this particular point in time? I know there's an incredible presence now we see of some online sites. And with rare exception, my experience with some of those sites is that I really do need to edit myself. And I think there are many of us who came of age at a time where, you know, we appreciate the steadying hand of an editor to make sure we can say what we're trying to say to a broad audience. You know, the idea of the printed, you know, physical black press, I mean, that's almost cliche at this point in time. But as it morphs into this online presence, I mean, what do you see as the future for the black press?
Right, well, inherently, I always try to be optimistic. And
we were spoiled. I mean, Africana was such a great model for, you know, how you can do this work at the highest level.
Yeah. And Africana sort of begat the root.com, which is now under the auspices of the Washington Post company. But on the one hand, you know, that kind of big corporate entity putting up a product, a news and information vehicle that is about a certain segment of our population, African Americans or Latinos or what have you, can be viewed as ghettoization.
Yeah.
I've had many conversations with black journalists here in the DC area, and we have this, many of them have a kind of mixed thing feeling about the root because, well, why didn't the Washington Post, which has, as we know, a very deep bench, highly skilled and very qualified black journalists and Latino journalists all throughout their editorial ranks. But the question can be asked legitimately, why don't you just cover more news, build it into your daily diet sort of thing? But The Root went up in 08. It's a great publication for the most part. It's only online. It doesn't have the same resources even as Slate, though, which is another Washington Post-owned online magazine, which is very high level, high big ideas, skilled people writing and editing there. You know, NBC Universal put up The Griot a couple of years ago, which is a black-only website. And you're right. I mean, there's a stark departure between these products in terms of the resources that they receive I should say a difference, not a departure, the resources they receive and the kind of footprint that they're able to achieve.
Right.
These are new. The traditional black press, the Chicago Defenders, the L.A. Sentinels, the Baltimore Afro-American, and what's the big one in New York? I can't believe it.
Amsterdam, New York Amsterdam.
Yes, Amsterdam. Pardon. Right. They are struggling. They're struggling. You know, they're. If you look at them online, their presence is, you know, it's not. It's got a ways to go, and that's because they don't have a lot of resources, you know. But the newer products that have corporate backing, they look great.
They look great, right? They're dynamic, right?
Don't really staff them up. You know, the NBC Universal or the Post company will shake loose some money to put a few editors that are on staff. But you're absolutely right. When you or I write for one of these outfits, we basically are one man or woman band.
Yeah.
And that is problematic because even though I'm really good and you're really thoughtful and you're really good, it always helps to have an editor both help you develop
right.
your idea on the front end, have right. brainstorm with you, talk about where you can go to sort right. of gel things, and then obviously help you with that organization and the line editing on the back end. And when that disappears, what you get is a product that is not as good as it could be. Let's put it that way. And that's a shame. It really is a shame.
You've been watching Left to Black. I'm your host, Mark Anthony Neal. We were joined this afternoon from Washington, D.C. by Amy Alexander, veteran journalist and author of the new book, Uncovering Race, A Black Journalist's Story of Reporting and Reinvention. It's published by Beacon Press. She is a 2008 fellow at the Nation Institute and has worked at many news outlets, including the Miami Herald, the Boston Globe, National Public Radio, and of course, lovingly, Africana.com. Thanks for joining us this afternoon, Amy.
Thank you, Mark. It was really fun. I'll see you soon.
Yes, take care.
Sometimes we think we shouldn't blame the people because it's we who have come to your country. On the other hand, we think, well, if they in the first place had not come to our country and have spread a false propaganda, we would never have come to theirs. If we had not come, we would not be the wiser. We would still have the good image of England, thinking that they are what they are not, and the English would be ignorant of us.
Welcome back to Left to Black. I'm your host, Mark Anthony Neal, and we're here in the studios at the John Hope Franklin Center for Interdisciplinary and International Studies in our Left to Black studios here. And we're joined today by a special guest, filmmaker John Akomfrah, who is coming to us from Britain, spending a few days on a kind of small visiting professorship here at Duke, talking about film, talking about your career. How are you doing today, John?
Very well, thank you, Mark. Thank you.
Let's go back to the beginning. You know, we're fortunate to have Julie Dash here a few months ago to celebrate, you know, the 20th anniversary of the Daughters of the Dust. And it's always interesting to find out from filmmakers, you know, when they found out they wanted to be filmmakers.
Okay. Yeah, well, I mean, in my case, it has, I suppose, three different formative moments, you know, the decision to. One was growing up in London in the late 60s, early 70s, living next to.
And you were born in Accra.
I was born in Accra, yeah. Right. But post the 66 coup that overthrew Nkrumah, my parents were involved with that party, so.
Had to go.
You do what Africans do, you gotta go. So. From the mid-60s onwards, we were in England. And I lived, grew up next to a fantastic independent cinema in London, which showed the best of world cinema. So I saw quite a bit.
And this is at a young age.
You know, very young age. Yeah. I mean, I used to try and sneak in when I was 12. And I did it for a year. And when I was 13, they said, okay, look, you can just come in, right? You don't need to sneak in. But sit in the corner and don't make any noise. All of that. So essentially, I saw the best of world cinema, you know, from the age of 13 onwards in this cinema. And I think the first instance of the will and ambition to make films started then. The second, I suppose, would be when I first saw the first wave of black independent cinema from this country. Yeah. This would have been the late 70s, early 80s. The films made by the generation just before Julie Dash, you know, Haile Gerima, Larry Clark.
The L.A. Rebellion, right?
The L.A. crowd,
right?
You know,
yeah.
And you saw that. And I remember thinking after I saw Bushmama, Haile Gerima's Bushmama.
Yeah.
Damn, we could do this. not because we have the skills, but you just saw it. The subject matter, the range of approaches, all of which were trying to nail something black. Essentially,
yeah,
we could do this.
I know 1982 you helped to found the Black Film Audio Collective.
Yes.
Talk a little bit about the founding of that. I mean, because, you know, it strikes me as interesting. You mentioned, you know, Gerima and folks like Charles Burnett, the L.A. Rebellion crowd. And then you see what's happening in Britain with the Black Film Audio Collective. It's the same time that Stuart Hall, you know, is really laying intellectually the foundations of what we now know of as, you know, black cultural studies, Britain, and then of course it transports over to the United States. You know, what was happening in black visual and sonic culture at the time that it seems as though so many forces were in sync, you know, artistically and intellectually at one time?
I mean, Stuart Hall probably names it best of all. And I think for him, this moment, the coming of black Britain, starts in the 70s, when my generation, the class of 76, as we call ourselves, you know, the people who reach voting age.
Right, that's interesting.
In that summer of 76, sort of had to decide whether we were going to be this hyphen identity, black British, what that meant in cultural and political terms.
Yeah.
And I think when he says, well, that generation rejected assimilation for something else, is the crucial epistemic or epistemological break.
Yeah.
I mean, I think people, my generation, suddenly thought, okay, we are the first generation to come of age in this culture. We have to know what it is to be black in this system. And we need to call on everything at our disposal, not just the political rhetoric, but also the sonic and cultural rhetorics.
Yeah. Yeah.
That really form communities, identities. So it starts then, and in the case of the black audio, what's interesting is that I met just about everyone in the collective at that moment. We're all at this college in 1976, you know, looking at each other thinking, I wonder if that guy knows anything. You know, so you stroll across and say, hi, my name's John, you know, who are you? Because you see him with a copy of Revolutionary Suicide under his arm.
Right.
You know, so literature, especially African-American literature, revolutionary literature of the late 60s.
Autobiography of Malcolm X, right.
You know, that
seize the time, right?
You know, yeah. All of that. In fact, the Stuart Hall movement comes from us much later.
Yeah.
It's really in the early 80s that we discover this guy.
And it's interesting, right? Cause when you see the trajectory of someone like Fela Kuti, mm-hmm. right? It's that same kind of experience, right? He gets, you know, there's obviously a reason for him to be politicized in Nigeria.
Yes.
But when he connects to African-American political and revolutionary literature, right? Yeah. It takes it to a whole nother space.
Yeah. I think all of diaspora communities outside of this place have at one time or another to have that dialogue with that tradition.
Yeah.
You know, and interestingly, most of us start with that autobiography of Malcolm X.
Right.
You read that and things are never quite the same again. Your whole life changes. And you know, we were no exception. Everybody in the group had read it. And I don't think it was just a question of mimicking something in that biography, because none of us were ex-drug dealers or pimps or anything, but we understood the narrative of transformation.
Right, right.
You know, we understood the narrative.
Which is ultimately the power of Malcolm X's story, right? You know, to see this man intellectually transform himself, right? His intellectual curiosity, right? Indeed. You know, and all those type of things.
He says, you are in a position A, and by dint of hard work, intellectual and otherwise, you can conceptually change how people see you and crucially how you see yourself. And I think that was a major, major kind of learning curve for us.
Mm. The first project that you're doing with Black Audio, you know, what are the audiences like? And I mention that because I remember when Spike Lee and Baraka were having their disputes and debates about Malcolm X, and Baraka once said to me in a conversation that, you know, it would have been better for Spike Lee just to make the film that he wanted to make without considering the market forces, right? Mm. And just show it to 20 people in a basement.
So
what was the audience like for Black Audio's, you know, initial work?
Then Baraka would have been very happy with us. That's kind of what we were showing. I mean, you know, I think for us, we were very clear in our minds that this was something new. There'd been individual, you know, auteurs, film auteurs, but there hadn't really been that attempt to set up collectives, art collectives, which took filmmaking
another level,
you know, to just that other level, you know. So in the beginning, we existed mainly in the galleries, art galleries, community centers, that sort of spaces, those sorts of spaces. But we also saw our task as one of trying to create an audience for this. So we would take it to prisons or schools. Do you know what I mean? The idea was not to
anywhere where an audience was captive, right?
Got that.
Right, on a range, you know, I mean that metaphorically on a bunch of levels, right?
Yeah. Where there were minds that were changed,
held
captive, we were up for it, you know. And that does create its own problems, because then you're, I suppose, flirting with you're existing largely in the orbit of elite culture, you know, the galleries and so on. And it took a while to then break from that, to reach some of the intended, you know, viewers that you wanted. You know, basically ordinary black folk, working class black people who had the same desires as we do.
The folks that you're making the films for,
I mean, they had the same desires as we do.
First film, Hands Worth Song,
right?
And of course, it's in reference to the Brixton riots. Talk a little bit about the process of working on that film.
Okay, well, I mean, Handsworth was, in a way, like a lot of films and projects we'd been involved with up to that point. It was just the one that we managed to have finished.
And this is 1986, right?
1986. But part of the job of the collective was to sort of set up networks across the country of people who we knew were interested in films. And we got a call from a group of them in Birmingham saying, look, there's a set of riots going on here. You need to come down and document it.
Wow.
So essentially what we went initially to do was just to document
just to shoot,
what was going on And it was only really weeks afterwards that something happened that was quite common. You realize that what you were watching and how what you were watching was reporting, was being reported in the mainstream media.
Very different.
Was at odds. Right, there was right, a discrepancy, right, right, a disjunct, right. You know. And this was something that's quite common, you know, that when you speak to most of the black collectives in England from the early 80s, they all say this, that the key point for them was to contest the representations of black people, cultures, because they felt that there was a discrepancy between their own experience.
And that becomes a generational mantra both in Britain, the United States, and obviously all throughout the diaspora, right? How do we disrupt?
Right.
How do we disrupt?
Yeah.
Well,
disrupt
the production and circulation of these images, right? You know, as a broader means of, you know, kind of disrupting things politically.
I don't think, I mean, my sense is that you never quite succeed.
Yeah.
You never quite succeed in doing this. But the ambition.
Yeah,
you know, the desire for secession,
the
refusenik posture, the braggadocio that says we really are.
You know, it goes back to Hall. You know, Hall talking about it's always this war of positions, right? You know, you're just repositioning yourself.
Exactly. And it is provisional and contingent, and you know, if you go hitting for it, thinking you might succeed, you're in for a shock because you'd never really ultimately succeed. I mean, if success means being able to completely transform the ways in which you're represented. That doesn't ever happen. But what does happen that I think is interesting is that you become part of a discourse. Yeah. People then say, oh, okay, well, we can't say this without bearing in mind that they, have said that. You know, so slowly you get locked into a war of that position that Stuart's talking about. But you have to at least speak first before you're considered in that debate. You know?
Absolutely. You're watching Left the Black. I'm your host, Mark Anthony Neal. We're here at the John Hope Franklin Center for Interdisciplinary and International Studies. We're joined this afternoon by Mr. John Akomfrah, filmmaker, well-known. And it's funny, you know, when you do the kind of traditional Google search, you know, experimental documentary filmmaker.
Yes,
it's like, you know, what exactly, what the hell does that mean, right, on some level, right?
Yes,
you know,
is
this, when it comes down to it, a filmmaker who's comfortable working in a narrative form, right, that breaks the mold of what we've been, you know, socialized to think as, you know, linear narrative, et cetera, et cetera. Right?
Well, I mean, on the whole, that's what, when people say experimental, that's what they mean. They say, that brother, he's breaking some rules.
Right.
And usually those rules are either conceptual, ideological, or aesthetic.
Right.
You know,
right.
In my case,
all
three.
Above,
because I'm both interested in the formal questions of experimentation as well as the theoretical questions.
Yeah.
I'm interested in changing at any one time what we mean by black.
Yeah.
What we mean when we say that's a black figure, as well as the means by which that speech gets arrived.
You know, it's funny, Kelly Jones, the art historian, was on a few weeks ago talking about her book, first of all, but also the series, Now Dig This, out in L.A. Mm. And we got into this conversation about experimentalism within black art, and this whole idea that if you don't experiment, you die.
Yes. I believe that.
And you know, and it's interesting when you mention the kind of audiences that ultimately we're all doing this kind of work for, you know. We seem to have bought the idea from the market that, you know, regular everyday folks can't deal with experimental, right?
Yes.
That they need that Larry. But what we find out time and time again is that even for them, it's a freeing experience.
Well, I mean, look, normally when people talk about experimentalism, they think it's about what happens in high culture.
Yeah,
music, film. But when you look at something that's close to both our hearts, what happened with R&B.
Right.
You know, I mean, what's Timbaland, what's Missy Elliott, what's Destiny's Child, without that knowledge, that notion of an experimental culture.
Yeah,
I mean, that stuff is, you know, there was a time when it was the most cutting edge thing anywhere.
Yeah.
Sonically.
Which raises an interesting question. Like, you know, I was fortunate to appear in one of your films.
You did?
About 50 pounds ago, 7 years, 50 pounds ago.
Stop.
But it's interesting, right? Because on the same way that you're known for this great documentary work, right? You know, BBC would reach out to you to do something that on some level, you know, is almost status quo and traditional, right? Yes. But you can still bring your sensibilities to what could simply have been a very boring, you know, documentary about contemporary R&B music, right?
Well, I mean, the ambition and desire was first to talk to folk like you, yeah. who knew that history.
Right. Greg Tate, you know, who's just simply
you,
brilliant.
Greg,
right.
You know, and as you listen to what you said, I think the overriding ambition then was to just do something that formally matched the ambitions of what you guys said. You know, and I thought, okay, well, I mean, sure, we could just do this in a very traditional way. This is the history. But that doesn't seem to match how and what you were saying. So we were pushed very much by that. And I think this goes back to another question that one has to raise when you talk about experimentation. I mean, for me, it's never just a question of, you know, arriving at this thing independent of the field of engagement.
Right.
You know, the question of experimentation is always, what is the field of engagement?
Yeah.
What is it suggesting to you? And what can you bring to the table?
Absolutely.
If you can't bring anything to the table, you're in trouble.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. You do two films in the early 1990s, and for those of you watching, this is Left to Black. I'm your host, Mark Anthony Neal. We're joined this afternoon by filmmaker John Akomfrah. You do two films in the early 1990s, Seven Songs for Malcolm X, and also Who Needs a Heart. Mm-hmm. And they're connected in interesting kind of ways. You know, one, to talk about Malcolm X, but also a British figure, Michael X, you know, who less folks know about, right? Yes. But clearly there are kind of connections between their lives.
Yes. I mean, they knew each other, and without Malcolm, they would almost certainly never have been a Michael.
Right.
You know, what interested me about the two figures, are really from two very different areas. My mother had met Malcolm when he spoke at her university in Ghana in 64.
Wow. Right. So that whirlwind of that last year of travel,
exactly.
Right?
64, 65, no, in fact, 64, because he was dead in February 65. Right. But, and so this figure was always in the family. I mean, she spoke about him before we even knew who he was.
Wow.
You know, we had this guy, he came, and his name was Malcolm X, and he said, you know, he was gonna die, and he pointed to people in the audience and said, these guys are, blah, 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 blah. You know, so he was really part of a kind of family folklore that defined us as a political family. You know, Malcolm's narrative was one that she offered to explain her radicality.
Wow.
And at some point, I just thought, you know, maybe we should do something about this guy. And the course of doing something about him, I came across this other guy who I didn't know.
Michael X. Right.
But there were kind of similarities between their stories, you know, in the sense that they both started in that underworld culture. And Malcolm persuades Michael that he needs to do something. But, you know, Michael is not Malcolm. Malcolm is one of the most brilliant African men ever. Michael was not.
And it's funny, you know, there's not enough attention paid to that part of Malcolm. I mean, we know about the fiery rhetoric, right? And we know about the politics, but, you know, very much less attention to Malcolm X as the intellectual, right? As the thinker and someone who was really, you know, agile as a thinker, right? You know, could move in various places, you know, very quickly.
The thing is, when you think about him, you always think about the fiery rhetoric, almost at the expense of the substance of the rhetoric,
right?
Right.
Because he's incredibly witty, right? Incredibly witty, right? And, you know, could have been a stand-up comedian in some other context. Right?
And I would listen to him, and you just get sucked and seduced by the cadences of the speech.
Yeah.
You know, he says, "We don't love anybody who doesn't love us." And you think,
And you know, the late Manning Marable, right? He talks about, you know, the influence of jazz. Right, that clearly, you know, Malcolm had his ear to the street in a kind of way that you hear it, you know, in his oratory. Yeah.
But I also, one of the reasons why Malcolm became an interesting figure for us was because he seemed to also come from that world, so many of us did, you know. Like, I didn't really realize until maybe a couple of years before we started to make the film on him that his family had been UNIA folk,
yeah.
that he had this whole Garveyite history, yeah. that his mother came from the Caribbean, right. and,
He's not an accident, right? He's not an accident, right?
I hadn't kind of, then the minute we figured that out, it was like, okay, time to make this work. And I wished we had got as much out of Michael as we did for Malcolm. Yeah. We didn't for different reasons, but I think it was important to say that this guy, this British guy, told you something about British society.
Yeah.
And why, the reasons why he wasn't Malcolm had as much to do with him as it did to do with the society.
Right. Yeah. You have a new film that's out, The Nine Muses.
Yes.
Talk a little bit about that.
I thought with The Nine Muses we should do something that we've hinted at for a long time but just never done,
yeah.
which is to take the implications of the lives of our parents, and do something about that.
It's a migration story.
Yeah, yeah. It's the sense that because almost all of us my age either came when we were very young mm-hmm. or were born in England.
Oh, born in England. Yeah.
And so most of our stories have been around that generation. Yeah. And I just, as I hit their age, I just thought we should do something about this generation. Because there are no epitaphs anywhere. There's nothing in London. London's obsessed with heritage.
Yeah.
Everywhere you go, there's signs. Mark Twain visited and lived here. Oliver Twist was written there. There's nothing like that for people of color.
Color, yeah.
And 3 to 5 million folk came from Africa, the Caribbean, and the Asian subcontinent. Most of them are now dead.
Yeah.
And there is no acknowledgement anywhere in the culture that they ever existed.
There's this great phrase that's been circulating the last few years, Afropolitan, as a way to talk about the cosmopolitan nature of African peoples. And in some ways, I think, that really hits the nail on the head in terms of your work.
Yes.
Right. Providing a nice kind of, Afropolitan view of the world, right? Where are Africans in the world? What are they saying? What are they doing? What is the art they're creating?
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, the thing is that in a kind of Afropolitan spirit, let's say, one of the things that I thought was worth stressing was just the different ways in which we become black across the planet, this need not necessarily then say that because we have these different roots, R-O-U-T-E-S, we can't have any affinity. We do, but there are slight differences of histories. And migration for us is one of those major ones.
Yeah.
When we arrive on different shores, differs
radically. Right, absolutely.
So it was just worth stressing. And the reasons, of course, differ quite
radically. And who's waiting there for us, right, when we get there, right?
I almost forgot that. So this is really an attempt, The Nine Muses, is an attempt to try and say something about the emergence of Black Britain, the emotional roots.
Yeah. And I have a good friend, political scientist, Richard Eyton, has a really great book on the Black Fantastic, and he gets into this conversation, distinction between roots, as those things that are in the ground, but also roots, right? The way that we travel, right?
Yeah. Yes. I mean, in this case, I'm talking about both.
Both
the journey, the R-O-U-T-E-S, but also the foundations.
Right.
Clearly the effective roots, where some of these feelings of alienation, estrangement, and belonging comes from.
Yeah.
Because they have a narrative, and the attempt is to provide that narrative.
Absolutely.
How do people go from being colonial subjects to post-colonial ones?
Right.
How do they go from being carried, a guy leaves.
And how do they go back and forth?
Right? Yeah. Right. A guy leaves Lagos, and for him, in 1955, he is Lagosian. He ain't even Nigerian, because the country don't exist. And he arrives in London, and he meets a guy from Kingston and another guy from Dominica, and they have to find a way of talking to each other.
Yeah.
And communicating not just where they've come from, but where they are.
Yeah.
Because, the guy says, well, actually, unless we become this one thing, we are going to individually die. Right. And so I'm trying to say something about the emotional context for that affinity, for that process. That's really what we're trying to deal with.
Yeah. You're watching Left to Black. I'm host Mark Anthony Neal. We're here with filmmaker John Akomfrah. Black Audio will be 30th anniversary next year, 2012. What has been the difference between trying to do that work in the early 1980s, where even the concept of a black filmmaker, you know, this is before Spike Lee, right? Even the concept of a black filmmaker is like foreign to many people. Now we're in a moment of digital technology. You know, folks now, because of YouTube and a range of others, can now have access to your work in ways that they would not have ever had access to it, you know, 20 years ago. How has the process changed?
I mean, I think you would be silly to suggest that there hasn't been any change. You know, that right, one of the defaults of black artists is to kind of stress the fact that nothing changes. But clearly in this case, a lot's changed. You know, I mean, for one, we were a tiny group, and now, as you quite rightly point out, across the world, people have access to the mechanisms by which images are made. And they are making.
And you're written into the legacy of black cultural production over the last, in ways that you probably could not have imagined 30 years ago. Right.
But I think there's a really interesting thing going on at the moment, and it's in relation to this thing we call multiculturalism. You know, because there's a temptation to say to young artists of color, look, it's done. Okay, you're now part of some whole. So, you know, you can go home, all right? We'll take care of it now. You know, TV's there, it'll do what you're trying to do. And I mean, my sense is that younger artists should resist that. That the search for difference is a permanent one. It's not, it never goes away.
It doesn't go away. You know,
And mining those seams and crevices for textures and cadences and affects that you say, this is who I am, is a necessary thing.
It's a human condition.
And we should continue to do that. So that's a change. In our case, you never had to, nobody had to say that.
Didn't have to be convinced of that right then.
You know what I mean? The Derridian necessity compelled you to do compelled you to do these things. Whereas I think now, artists and filmmakers of color have to think and make that choice consciously in a way that I'm not sure that we did.
And I mean, the weird kind of post-black debate, right? You know, whether it's, you know, Thelma Godin's work or someone like Torre trying to wax poetic about it. You know, it comes out of that kind of moment. You know, what do we do with this? You know, something has happened. We're post something, but what exactly is it?
I mean, I think what's interesting about the term post-black is that it really was an attempt to do, to say something about an aesthetic shift, which was then read as a major political shift.
And I would argue an aesthetic shift that actually broadened the contours of blackness as opposed to delimiting it.
And whilst I was really for the term in the context of the aesthetic shift, I can see what it means. I'm slightly less comfortable with it as a
because we start hearing post-race, echoed in post-black,
And I mean, to the extent that post-black suggests that there are certain sensibilities that are now being organized by things that are not part of the tradition, that's clearly happening. But if post-black suggests that the questions that animated the need for the category black have now been transcended, then no. I mean, I think it's one of those interesting moments. It's neither one thing or the other. One would like it to be. There are lots of people who want it to be one thing or the other, but I just don't think it is. I mean, I think it's naive to suggest that there have been no changes, but it's equally naive to say that the changes are such that everything's...
That we don't have to pay attention to these things anymore.
That I don't believe.
You've been watching Left to Black. I'm Mark Anthony Neal, your host. We're here at the John Hope Franklin Center for Interdisciplinary and International Studies at our Left to Black Studios. We've been joined, thankfully, this afternoon by John Akomfrah, talking about his film career and talking about the great work he did, has been doing for some time, beginning with the founding of the Black Audio Film Collective. Thanks for joining us this afternoon, John.
Thank you. It's good to see you again.
Thank you.
produced by Duke University, online at duke.edu.